Hello, I am Dr. Srinivasa E, Assistant Professor of Physics. In this video, I am going to explain some phenomena in polarization, which is a syllabus for 2nd BSc, 3rd SEM students prescribed by Coimbatore University. So this is a chapter in the paper Optics and Electrostatics, and the session number is 37. The learning objectives of this session are concept of principal refractive indices, Eigen's construction of ordinary wavefront, and Eigen's construction of extraordinary wavefront. Prerequisites for this session are concept of polarization phenomenon exhibited by light, unpolarized light and its representation, plane polarized light and its representation, plane of vibration and plane of polarization, double refraction, ordinary ray and extraordinary ray, optic axis, uniaxial and biaxial crystal, and positive and negative crystals. These are the phenomena I am explained in the session number 36 already. Principal refractive indices. In double refracted system, the ordinary ray travels with the same velocity in all directions. The extraordinary ray travels with different velocities in different directions. But both the rays travel with the same velocity along the direction of optic axis. In doubly refracting uniaxial crystal, there are two principal refractive indices, one for ordinary ray and the other for extraordinary ray, because in a doubly refracting crystal, a single ray splits up into ordinary ray and extraordinary ray. Principal refractive index for O ray or ordinary ray. Since the velocity of O ray is constant in all directions within the crystal, the principal refractive index for O ray is defined as ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of O ray in the crystal. That is mu O, that is refractive index for O ray is equal to ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of ordinary ray in the crystal. If C is the velocity of light in air vacuum and VO is the velocity of ordinary ray in the crystal, then mu O is equal to C by VO. Principal refractive index for E ray or extraordinary ray. The principal refractive index for E ray is defined as ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of E ray in a direction perpendicular to the optic axis in the crystal. Principal refractive index for E ray is denoted by mu E. Here E is the capital E, is equal to ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of extraordinary ray perpendicular to the optic axis in the crystal, because velocity of E ray perpendicular to the optic axis depends upon the type of the crystal. Mu E is equal to C, I mean velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of extraordinary ray, that is VE. Principal refractive index for E ray for positive crystal. For positive crystal, the velocity of E ray in a direction perpendicular to the optic axis is minimum. That is, velocity of the extraordinary ray is less than velocity of ordinary ray. Hence, mu e is greater than mu o. Therefore, the principal refractive index for E ray for positive crystal is defined as ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the velocity of E ray in the crystal. That is mu e. Here e is the small e is equal mu e is equal to ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the minimum velocity of E ray in the crystal. Because for positive crystal, velocity of the extraordinary ray is less than the velocity of the ordinary ray perpendicular to the optic axis. Therefore, we have taken minimum velocity of E ray in the crystal. If C is the velocity of light in air vacuum and VE minimum is the minimum velocity of E ray in the crystal, then mu e is equal to c by ve minimum. Example for positive crystal, quartz crystal. Example for positive crystal is quartz crystal. For quartz crystal, mu e is equal to 1.553 and mu o is equal to 1.544. mu e is greater than mu o. Mu e is greater than mu o. Principal refractive index for E ray for negative crystal. For negative crystal, the velocity of E ray in a direction perpendicular to the optic axis is maximum. That is, VE is greater than VO. Hence, mu e is less than mu o. Therefore, the principal refractive index for E ray for negative crystal is defined as ratio of velocity of light in air vacuum to the maximum velocity of E ray in the crystal. So mu e is equal to velocity of light in air vacuum over maximum velocity of extraordinary ray in the crystal, because in negative crystal velocity of the extraordinary ray is maximum perpendicular to the optic axis. So we have taken maximum velocity of E ray in the crystal. Mu e is equal to c by ve maximum, where c is the velocity of light in air vacuum and ve maximum is the maximum velocity of E ray in the crystal perpendicular to the optic axis. So mu e is equal to c by ve maximum. Ve maximum, ve is large, so mu e is less. Hence mu e is greater than mu o. Example for negative crystal is calcite. For calcite, the refractive index of extraordinary ray is equal to 1.486 and refractive index for ordinary ray is equal to 1.658. That is, the value of mu e is less than the 1.68, that is the value of refractive index of ordinary ray. That is, mu e is less than mu o for negative crystal. Huygens' explanation of double refraction. According to Huygens' theory, each point on a wavefront acts as a fresh source of disturbance and send secondary wavelets in all directions with the same velocity as that of the original source. He explained the phenomenon of double refraction in uniaxial crystal with the help of a secondary wavelets which are emitting from the wavefront, I mean primary wavefront. When any wavefront strikes a doubly refracting crystal, every point of the crystal becomes a source of two wavefronts. One for ordinary wavefront, so which is corresponding to ordinary ray, and the other is extraordinary wavefront corresponding to the extraordinary ray, because in a doubly refracting crystal, a single ray splits up into two rays one ray is called ordinary ray and the other one is extraordinary ray. In uniaxial crystals, the O ray travels with the same velocity in all directions in the crystal. Hence, wavefront of O ray is spherical in nature. Whether it may be a positive crystal or negative crystal, the wavefront due to ordinary ray is spherical. The E ray travels with different velocity in different direction. Hence, wavefront of E ray is ellipsoid in nature, whether the crystal is positive or negative crystal. For negative crystal, this is the ellipsoidal surface for extraordinary ray, and this is the ellipsoidal surface for extraordinary ray for positive crystal. Since no double refraction occurs in the direction of optic axis, the surfaces of sphere and ellipsoid touch each other at two points. Here, this is the optic axis. Along the optic axis, both sphere and ellipsoid touch each other at these two points. The line joining these two points gives the direction of optic axis of the crystal. So, the line joining these two points gives the direction of the optic axis. Consider S is the point source which send out both ordinary and secondary, waves from the point source. Since ordinary ray travels with the same speed in all directions within the crystal, it forms a spherical wavefront. Whereas extraordinary ray in a negative crystal having maximum velocity perpendicular to the optic axis, therefore it travels a larger distance, forms a ellipsoidal surface. Since for a negative crystal, VE is greater than VO perpendicular to the direction of the optic axis, the ellipsoid forms outside the spherical surface, or spherical surface forms inside the ellipsoidal surface. For positive crystal, velocity of the extraordinary ray is less than the velocity of the ordinary ray. Velocity of the extraordinary ray is less than the velocity of the ordinary ray in a direction perpendicular to the optic axis. Therefore, the ellipsoidal surface forms inside the spherical surface. Huygens' explanation of double refraction for negative and positive crystal. As I told you, in negative crystals like calcite, VE is less greater than VO, velocity of the extraordinary ray is greater than velocity of the ordinary ray in a direction perpendicular to the optic axis. If we consider a point source S of monochromatic light within the crystal, V is maximum along a direction perpendicular to the direction of optic axis. The sphere is thus enclosed in the ellipsoid. In positive crystal like quartz, VE is less than VO perpendicular to the direction of the optic axis. This is the optic axis and this is the perpendicular to the direction of the optic axis. VE is less than VO. The ellipsoid is therefore enclosed inside the sphere as shown in this figure. The ellipsoid is enclosed inside the sphere. So we'll start the session number 38. In this session, students will understand and learn the concept of Huygens construction of ordinary wavefront in oblique and normal incidence and Huygens construction of extraordinary wavefront in oblique and normal incidence. First, we will discuss the oblique incidence. So, in the case of Huygens construction for O ray and E wavefronts, in the case of optic axis in the plane of incidence and parallel to the crystal surface, O and E wave incidence parallel to the crystal surface and in the plane of incidence, parallel to the crystal surface and in the plane of incidence. Let AB is the, this is AB, plane wavefront, is represented by the parallel beam. Parallel beam gives rise to plane wavefront AB incident obliquely on the crystal surface PQ of negative crystal. Example for negative crystal is calcite. The refracted spherical and ellipsoidal wave surfaces touch each other along the line PQ, that is along optic axis as shown in the figure. The spherical surface due to ordinary wave and the ellipsoidal wave due to extraordinary wave in the crystal touches along the optic axis. This is the optic axis, because along the haptic axis both ordinary ray and extraordinary ray travels with the same speed, but perpendicular to the direction of the optic axis for negative crystal, VE is greater than VO. Therefore, extraordinary ray forms the ellipsoidal surface. The time taken by the incident wavefront to reach C from B is T is equal to BC by V. The time taken by the incident wavefront to reach C from B, which is traveling in the air, is given by T is equal to BC by V, where BC is the distance traveled and V is the velocity of light in air. T is equal to BC by V because V, velocity, is equal to distance traveled over time taken. Therefore, time taken is equal to distance traveled in air, that is BC by V, where V is the velocity of light in air. Oblique incidence continues. During the time the ray travels from B to C in air, the ordinary ray travels a distance equal to AM in the negative crystals like calcite, whereas extraordinary ray travels a distance equal to AN. So extraordinary ray travels a distance AN and ordinary ray travels a distance equal to AM. During the time the ray travels a distance BC with a velocity V. Therefore, time taken by the ordinary ray to travel distance AM in the crystal is given by T is equal to AM by VO, where AM is the distance traveled by the ordinary ray in the crystal and VO is the velocity of the ordinary ray, and it equal to AN by VE, where AN is the distance traveled by the extraordinary ray with a velocity VE, that is equal to BC by V, because all are taken same time. If we equate AM by VO is equal to BC by V, AM by VO is equal to BC by V, we get AM is equal to BC by V into VO. that is equal to BC by mu O, where mu O is the refractive index of the ordinary ray. It is given by mu O is equal to V by V O, where V is the velocity of light in air and V O is the velocity of the ordinary ray. Here V O by V, so V by V O is equal to mu O, V O by V is 1 by mu O. Therefore, AM is equal to BC by mu O. Similarly, if we equate these two, AN by VE is equal to BC by V, we will get equation for AN. So, AN is equal to BC by V, BC by V into VE, multiply here, is equal to BC by mu E, because mu E is equal to V by VE, where V is the velocity of light in air and V is the velocity of the extraordinary ray in the crystal, where mu and mu E are the refractive indices of ordinary and extraordinary rays respectively. The O ray and E rays travel with different velocities in different directions. The semi-minor axis of the ellipsoid is given by AM is equal to BC by mu O. The semi-minor axis is given by AM is equal to BC by mu O. Refractive index for ordinary ray. Similarly, the semi-major axis is given by BC by mu E. BC by mu E, where mu E is the refractive index of principal refractive index of extraordinary ray. Normal incidence. We will discuss about the normal incidence. Again, this parallel beam gives rise to plane wave front AB, which is incident on the crystal surface, negative crystal surface PQ, which is along the optic axis. The crystal surface in the plane of the incidence. Let AB is the incident wave front, which is incident normally on the surface PQ of the negative crystal, say calcite. MN is the refracted wavefront tangential to the spherical wavefront of O ray. Here this is M and this is N. MN is the refracted wavefront tangential to the ordinary wavefront. RS is the refracted wavefront tangential to the ellipsoidal wavefront. These are ellipsoidal wavefront formed due to extraordinary ray. So RS is the refracted wavefront tangential to the ellipsoidal wavefront of E ray. Both the wavefronts MN and RS are parallel to the refracting surface. PQ is the refracting surface. Here MN is the refracted wavefront due to ordinary ray. RS is the refracted wavefront due to extraordinary ray. These two wavefronts are parallel to the crystal surface PQ. Here, when a ray incident normal to the crystal surface in the plane of incidence along the optic axis, perpendicular to the optic axis, the points A and B gives rise to secondary wavelets. The secondary wavelets of ordinary ray travels with the same speed in all direction within the crystal, gives rise to spherical wavefront. Whereas extraordinary waves travels with the maximum velocity perpendicular to the direction of the optic axis. Therefore, they forms ellipsoidal wavefront. So here extraordinary ray moves faster than the ordinary ray, gives rise to ellipsoidal wavefront. The tangential refracted ordinary wavefront and extraordinary wavefront are both parallel to the crystal surface PQ. Here AO, this is AO due to ordinary ray, and AE is the extraordinary ray both travel with the different velocity in same direction. Both travel in the same direction with different velocity. Both traveling along the same direction with different velocities, therefore, a definite path difference introduced between the ordinary ray and extraordinary rays. Here, there is a path difference between the ordinary ray and extraordinary ray. Extraordinary ray is moving ahead with the ordinary ray with the same distance A, here MR and NS is the path difference between the ordinary ray and extraordinary ray. This path difference concept is introduced to study the quarter and half wave plates. This principle is used in the construction of quarter wave and half wave plates. These are the books I used for reference. Thanking for watching.